Hello everyone and welcome back to Astrox Imperium. We're going to be taking a look at build 103. Today's date is the 27th of August 2020. Alright guys, well I've been busy back here and it looks like we've got some real goodies and some new additions to the game that I think you guys are really going to like. So I'm going to go ahead and run through these. It shouldn't take too long. This video should probably be about normal time. Alright, the first thing we're going to do here is jump into the continue screen, and you will notice that there is now a new button that has appeared here, and I've kind of made a little bit of graphical changes to some of these just so that they can stand out better on that background. So when you click on your pilot here, that will load you up just like normal, but if you click on this little green arrow icon, you will now notice that it loads up all the backups that you've created for that particular pilot. And if by chance you're not interested in any of those backups or you didn't want anything like that, you can click this back button or you can click on your image again and that will refresh you back to the main page. All right, what we're going to do is we're going to open up our pilot here. And you can see that I've currently got three backups for this pilot. You'll notice that my current gain time on my main guy here is 90 hours, 27 minutes, and 7 seconds. And then you can see that all of these other backups are right about the same time. And once you've selected your pilot, it will give you the ability to create a new backup. So I can go right here and I can click that. And it'll take just a second. And you'll see we have a new backup now. So we've got, where is it? Right here, 27.8. Now what it does is it doesn't want you to keep creating backups of the same backup. So to prevent that from happening, it will check the timestamp on that. And when I go and click to create another backup, you can see it's not doing anything. It's just giving me a little indicator like, hey, that's not working. So now I have four backups for this account. If for some reason I don't want a backup, you can just click on that little X and it will pop it away out of the mix there for you. And you can see we're back to our three main backups. Now, if you want to restore an existing backup, you just click on the backup and click the restore button. And what that'll do is immediately replace your existing save with that restored backup save and load the game up for you. So what this is doing now is allowing players to start to separate their saves and make it so that they can kind of explore things that they might not have explored or do things that they might not have done without a safety point that they can go back to without having ruined their save game. So if you open up your save game folder, you will notice that those backup saves are in zip format. So they're already zipped up, they're already compressed, and they're ready for you to archive away manually if you so choose, or you can just leave them right there. As you can see, as I just showed you, you can manage those backups right there from the title screen. And if you notice, it doesn't really matter. It's going to show multiple backups for whatever guys that you have, and there is currently no limit to the number of backups that you can have on that account. However, I suspect that once you start getting up there, if you're the kind of guy that's going to hoard, you know, 50 plus backups of your guy, then you're probably going to run into a little bit of lag, or you're going to have to wait for all of these things to load up. So that's something to consider. If you're going to be managing large number of backups, that it will take some time for them to load up. So you might want to just keep 2, 3, 5, I would say no more than 10 main backups on your save, and then anything else, keep it archived somewhere else. All right. I think that pretty much covers everything with the backup system. So let's go ahead and jump into one of these games. We'll just jump into our main one here. And I'm going to show you what I've also added that is something that we have been wanting and complaining about for some time. Okay, so let me go ahead and turn some of this music down here. We'll just turn the master volume down so that it doesn't interfere with the video. And what we're going to do is let's head over to a station here. It looks like we're going to be docking at Astrox Security Patrol. All right, once we dock in this station, I can show you what I'm talking about here. Because for some time, players have discussed with me and expressed that they weren't happy with the fact that you needed to purchase a shuttle, fly to a location to purchase a ship that you wanted, so that you can keep your ships relatively in the same spot. or, you know, accessible. Well, now we have this. So you can jump into the shipyard, and you'll notice now that not only do you have the market and the ship dock, but you also have remote ships. Now, what this is doing is giving you a list of every ship that you own that is not at this particular station. And you can mouse over and look at the stats of those ships like you normally would. But by clicking a ship, rather than getting the activation or sell buttons, you're getting an option to move this ship to this station. Now, the ship is warped instantly. There is no timer. There is no waiting. You can have that ship at your disposal instantly. However, you are going to pay based on the mass and the cargo that is in that ship. So if you think that you're just going to subvert some missions by stacking cargo into a ship and instantly transporting it, you'll find that you're paying quite a hefty price to move cargo through warps. So that's something you're going to keep an eye out for. Or if for some reason you run into a ship that is extremely expensive, like something like this that only has a value of, let's say, $1 million and they want $5 million, if you are to, let's say, we'll move that ship to this station, we'll go ahead and do it. And then if you look in the ship dock, you'll see that that ship has been moved right here, and we'll activate that ship. And then once that ship is activated, you can almost guarantee that, there you go, we've got some hefty, very heavy and expensive cargo in that ship that was transported. So the cargo that is in the ship will be transported to the new location. However, you're going to pay a pretty price for it. It is not cheap. All right, so that is definitely something that we've been looking for some time. And now I'm going to show you another one that some of you guys are really going to like. Okay, so one of the suggestions that it has been suggested a number of times and required quite a bit of work behind the scenes to figure out what I needed to do exactly to be able to separate the target information between the autopilot and the ship target itself. Now, although the code did have variables that would control either of those game objects, the way that I've set it up now is allowing you to do something very cool. So let's go ahead and open up a few of these panels here so you can see what the heck is going on. And what we're going to do is we are going to go into our options. And if you look in under here, under the extra options, I happen to have this double click autopilot select option toggled on. Now, by default, that is off. So I'll go ahead and show you what happens. It's pretty much what you're normally used to. You can see I've only got two things here in my targeting panel. So the way it works is if I click a target, it says, okay, you've now scanned that target. If I click a target that I've already scanned, the game is going to assume that my autopilot wants to go to that target, considering that my autopilot has already been activated. So let's go ahead and turn off autopilot so that we just come to a complete stop, right? And you'll see the ship slow down and the ship will come to a stop. If I click another rock, nothing happens. The ship doesn't move anywhere. But as soon as I click it again, it has now targeted that rock. And again, the ship will not move anywhere. If you were to double click that rock, so let's select something else so that it's not there. But if I double click that rock, it will immediately activate the autopilot and my ship will head over into that direction. So that is all the same. So let me show you what happens when I turn on the double click autopilot select. And what this allows me to do is now with my autopilot going in one direction and locked onto that rock, I can change my target. You can see I can now select a completely different target for my ship without affecting the autopilot. Now, I can double click and that target will still immediately switch to my autopilot. But what this does is it prevents you from accidentally changing your autopilot destination just by clicking another item. However, this will affect going through warp gates. So if you decide that you're interacting with a different object other than the autopilot target, which is your warp gate, it will not auto jump you until that warp gate is your selected target. So what that'll do is, let's say you're fighting an NPC and you don't want to warp through the gate, you can have your auto target selected, have the gate and the NPC selected, and once the NPC is killed or the raider, it will select the gate and warp you through the gate. So it just gives you a little bit more control and kind of divides up that functionality so that if you so choose to, let's say I'm headed to the station, but I'm in the middle of fighting a pirate, I can still target that pirate while I'm flying to the station, activate my modules, and do everything like I normally would do while my autopilot is continuously moving to that particular target. Now, I do plan on adding a few more features in. I've already compiled this build for 103. Obviously, I'm doing the video for it. But I did make some notes with some playtesting. And rather delay this build any longer, I'm going to go ahead and get this out because it does have a number of bug fixes and a few things that are going to make things a lot easier for a number of players. So I wanted to go ahead and get that out before I decided to add in some new functionality for this new autopilot system that will show a new indicator on the targeting HUD, allowing you to know not just the targeting HUD, but also in the targeting panel, which target you have as your autopilot target. So that way, just at a glance, you'll be able to see what your autopilot is going towards. Granted, if it's a big deal, or if you're aware that your autopilot target is not what you wanted and you actually want it to be the target, just double click. Regardless of that option, the double click will always set your autopilot. The difference is how it's going to select that targeting. So now with the double click selected, it lets me change my target without changing the autopilot. And if you foresee that you do not like that system, or it's something that you only want to use in certain times of combat or whatever, it is completely toggleable from the game options. So that is a big deal. All right, let's take a look at some of the bugs that I had to cover. There were some issues with some of the ECM resistances. The ECM resistances were not calculating properly, and actually it was a pretty major thing considering a single decimal place point is a big deal in a game like this where the percentages are calculated from 0 to 1. So yeah, sorry about that, guys. I got it fixed. It is now properly rejecting the ECM. If you have very high ECM resistance, it's going to give you a lot less hassle from the various ships using ECM stuff. All right, let's see. What else did I do? I changed a few things on the title screen with some of the effects to kind of to make things a little bit better. And I also made a number of changes to some of the mobility code for all of the dual barrel modules. So the dual barrel projectile modules had a different mobility, and it was something that I had done deliberately because it was firing 2 shots, but a lot of that had already been compensated for the balancing between those modules with the fire time and other things. So rather than further penalize you with limited mobility, I jacked that mobility back up to the original, which should match all of the mobility for the single barrel weapons. So we've got that taken care of. I did make some changes to the way that the crates were being spawned. There was a bug in build 102 that was allowing drop loot crates to spawn very far away from the target that was destroyed. So that has also been addressed. All right. I added in another small graphical option for some of you guys who are interested in adjusting how long those engine trails are. So now you can see I can drop that engine trail time down to something very low, and then when undocking and flying around from the station, you'll notice that my engine trails are not going to be super long like they were before. So you can keep them short if you want. You can turn them all the way down. They will still give you a little bit of a flicker of distance or something, and I may choose to modify that so that if you do turn it down to 0, it will completely eliminate the engine trail. Maybe I'll take a look at that in the next build. All right, what else do we got here? We covered that. Engine trail we've got. We talked about all the backups. I think that's pretty much it. I did do some little bit of bug checking and validation for some of the sector map names. There were a few things that if something went wrong in your game, some of this lack of file validation would try to load in a file that didn't exist or a bad file name, you know, based on whatever, you know, whether you were importing a pilot or trying to create a backup. So now what I've done is I've made it validate that information, especially with ship files as well. And that will help remove the black screen of death. Anytime you get the black screen in the game, it doesn't mean your game is completely destroyed. Quite the contrary, it just means that something didn't load in properly. So as I'm going through and validating that information, it should give you a lot less of those types of errors. Alrighty, I think that is it. Oh, one thing that I did do with the addition of wormholes, we're getting lots of crates and stuff, and also with the persistent crates, that is making the sectors get a little bit heavy with the crates, which can lag the game down. So what I've done is now added a slow trickle persistent timer to the crate. So even though the crate is unsealed, it will slowly trickle down if it happens to be a loot crate. So it's something to keep in mind. Those crates will very slowly dissipate even though you haven't opened them. I think I have it dissipating at like a 1.5% rate, or I'm sorry, about 15% of the normal rate of decay for those crates. So now you got to kind of keep an eye on that. It will kind of self-clean, and I am also working on NPCs going around and robbing crates. So I'm going to have a new task that is going to be put into the NPC AI that not only will you be able to use by activating the auto task on a mercenary, so you will be able to tell mercenaries to go and collect crates, the transport mercs or recon mercs. And so once I get that implemented, I'll do the same for the non-player characters, the NPCs that are flying around, so that if you're getting into a big battle or you're taking witness to one of these upcoming NPC wars, you will have other NPC ships raiding that battlefield for crates. So that should also help to eliminate the excess crates floating around during high battle times or and whatnot, since now those crates will stay on the map forever. All right, guys, I think that pretty much sums up everything I wanted to cover in this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, make sure you hit that like button. If you're new, go ahead and subscribe. And I think that pretty much is it. I'm going to be focused on polishing up a couple of these little new mechanics that I've added. And I'm working on the addition of documents. You'll notice that I have added in a new advanced option document that is attached to the main intro tutorial. And basically that just covers a few little bits of information about tailoring the game so that you don't hate it. So if you are not a fan of the life support, you're not a fan of skill times having, you know, or skill, training skills having a timer, you can turn all of that stuff off, and this introduction document will kind of walk you through some of that. And also just explain a little bit the mentality and methodology behind the development of this game so that it can be tailored to a variety of play styles. So if you're interested, make sure you redo the tutorial with Jessa Din, the introduction tutorial, and she will hand you a new document for your journal. So over the next couple weeks, I'll be working on a few more of these documents and starting to add in some more scripting stuff for NPC interactions before I launch out the first storyline, which is, I've played 80% of it all the way through. You know, once I run into a bug, I kind of go back. I have to change some code. I got to fix some things. So I've got it through about 80% playthrough testing of the first, I think I got about 14 missions in there. So it's definitely coming along, but that's something I really want to make sure is working properly. The last thing I need is just destroying the game by adding in bad campaign missions that pretty much break everything. So far so good. It's going in the right direction, but I haven't finished testing it all, and I'll probably make some more changes and tweaks. I mean, it's pretty much every time I go through that, I end up with a list of stuff I want to tweak. But anyway, it is coming. It won't be long. All right, guys. Well, I appreciate you watching the video, and I'll see you guys next time. Momoguru signing out.